Prester John by John Buchan. The book bears a dedication to Lionel Phillips. Time, they say, must the best of us capture, and travel and battle and gems and gold no more can kindle the ancient rapture, for even the youngest of hearts grows old. But in you, I think, the boy is not over. So take this medley of ways and wars as the gift of a friend and a fellow lover of the fairest country under the stars. John Buchan. Chapter 1. The Man on the Kirkcaple Shore. I mind as if it were yesterday my first sight of the man. Little I knew at the time how big the moment was with destiny, or how often that face seen in the fitful moonlight would haunt my sleep and disturb my waking hours. But I mind yet the cold grew of terror I got from it, a terror which was surely more than the due of a few truant lads breaking the Sabbath with their play. The town of Kirkcaple, of which and its adjacent parish of Portincross my father was the minister, lies on a hillside above the little bay of Capel and looks squarely out on the North Sea. Around the horns of land which enclose the bay, the coast shows on either side a battlement of stark red cliffs, through which a burn or two makes a pass to the water's edge. The bay itself is ringed with fine clean sands, where we lads of the Burg School loved to bathe in the warm weather. But on long holidays the sport was to go farther afield among the cliffs, for there, and there were many deep caves and pools, where podleys might be caught with the line, and hid treasures sought for at the expense of the skin of the knees and the buttons of the trousers. Many a long Saturday have I passed in a crinkle of the cliffs, having lit a fire of driftwood, and made believe that I was a smuggler or a Jacobite new landed from France. There was a band of us in Kirkcaple, lads of my own age, including Archie Leslie, the son of my father's session clerk, and Tam Dyke, the provost's nephew. We were sealed to silence by the blood oath, and we bore each the name of some historic pirate or sailorman. I was Paul Jones, Tam was Captain Kidd, and Archie, need I say it, was Morgan himself. Our tryst was a cave, where a little water called the Dive Burn had cut its way through the cliffs to the sea. There we foregathered in the summer evenings and of a Saturday afternoon in winter, and told mighty tales of our prowess and flattered our silly hearts. But the sober truth is our deeds were of the humblest, and a dozen of fish or a handful of apples was all our booty, and our greatest exploit a fight with the roughs at the Dive Tanwork. My father's spring communion fell on the last Sabbath of April, and on the particular Sabbath of which I speak, the weather was mild and bright for the time of year. I had been surfeited with the Thursday's and Saturday's services, and the two long diets of worship on the Sabbath were hard for a lad of 12 to bear, with the spring in his bones and the sun slanting through the gallery window. There still remained the service on the Sabbath evening, a doleful prospect, for the Reverend Mr. Murdoch of Kilchristie, noted for the length of his discourses, had exchanged pulpits with my father. So my mind was ripe for the proposal of Archie Leslie on our way home to tea, that by a little skill we might give the kirk the slip. At our communion the pews were emptied of their regular occupants, and the congregation seated itself as it pleased. The manse seat was full of the Kirkcaple relations of Mr. Murdoch, who had been invited there by my mother to hear him, and it was not hard to obtain permission to sit with Archie and Tam Dyke in the cock loft in the gallery. Word was sent to Tam, and so it happened that three abandoned lads duly passed the plate and took their seats in the cock loft. But when the bell had done jowing, and we heard by the sounds of their feet that the elders had gone into the kirk, we slipped down the stairs and out of the side door. We were through the churchyard in a twinkling, and hot foot on the road to the Dive Burn. It was the fashion of the genteel in Kirkcaple to put their boys into what were known as Eton suits, long trousers, cutaway jackets, and chimney pot hats.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.